Greetings! I am Herbert Erpaderp, and it has become Thursday, so that means it's time for Ask a Herbert Erpaderp. That's not to say Ask a Herbert Erpaderp happens every Thursday, but it happens on some Thursdays, and this is one of them. Unless you're a patron, and then it happens on Wednesdays. Before I get to the questions, I'm going to tell you some things. First, I've made some changes for patrons. If you're a patron, you'll now be able to see my videos up to 4 days early. That means my modelling videos will now be available for patrons on Thursdays, instead of the Saturday. The videos are still going to be made public on Mondays, so unless you're a patron, there won't be any change. I've made that decision because I'd been late uploading the videos too often and I figured it wasn't good enough. This way, if I have some issues and the video is late, it'll still be 3 days early. Also concerning patrons, I will now be accepting questions from patrons in voice form. That is to say, if you're a patron and you want to, you can make a recording of yourself asking the question, send it to me, and I'll use that instead of voicing the question myself. It might save me a few minutes of time. Or if you would prefer, you could ask the question in a voice channel on Discord and I could record it that way. So if you have a question you want to voice personally, get in touch with me and we'll sort it out. Also, it's probably worth mentioning that there won't be a modeling video next week. Wait, that's not entirely true. There will be one going public next week, but there won't be one for patrons next week, so there won't be one going public the week after. Is that confusing enough? So there will be a modeling video on Monday the 12th, but not the week after, which is the 19th. There are reasons, including the fact that I have a bunch of voice work that needs to get done, and I'll be losing an entire day to ride the Remembrance Day steam train. Though losing a day isn't really the right wording. That should be quite fun, and I will be making a video about it, so I guess you've got that to look forward to. Also, Desert Bus starts on the 11th, and that's one of my favourite things that happens each year. I will still be working on models and videos, trying to focus on painting while Desert Bus is going, but I won't be recording any voiceovers or anything like that, and those are obviously quite important to the video. I'm treating the week as a kind of holiday because, well, why not? Okay, I don't think there's anything else to add there. This is probably going to be a slightly longer one because it's been 3 weeks since the last Ask a Herbert Erpaderp, so buckle up, and let's get to the questions. First, B-Man said, do you listen to Blind Guardian or Iced Earth? And if so, do you have any albums or songs that you really like? I do really enjoy both bands, and I managed to see Iced Earth a couple of years ago. They were really, really good. I would have really liked to see them with Matt Barlow, but Stu Block is pretty rad too. I missed Blind Guardian when they came out. I know I've told this story a few times on stream, and probably a couple of times on Ask a Herbert Erpaderp too. But when Blind Guardian came to Australia a few years ago, I want to say 2007 or something like that, they only played in Melbourne, so of course I bought tickets, booked flights and hotels, and then a few days before the show I was hospitalised. I don't even remember exactly what it was, but it was related to diabetes and probably excessive drinking as well. But the doctor told me that I absolutely couldn't fly, and to be honest, I didn't feel like I could argue, I was that sick. It's one of my biggest regrets, not that I could really have done anything about it, but it does suck. I've always had a hard time picking favourites, especially when it comes to music, and in my opinion, both bands put out so much great material that it's hard to choose. Even the Demons and Wizards side project is really good. That said, I'm pretty fond of the Nightfall in Middle-earth album by Blind Guardian. Top Bunk Productions said, do you have any particular pet peeves? Not anything majorly aggravating, just small things you find annoying enough to notice, yet small enough to not bother fixing. For me, it's when differently coloured pavement slabs in a pattern have some slabs that are way off where they're supposed to be. I do have plenty of peeves. I guess some that fit this description would be when somebody writes, hence why, when they're trying to sound smart. It's like saying, why, and it sounds stupid. To be fair though, I do say a lot of stupid stuff myself, so, you know, I'm not innocent. Or when somebody comes to the door and instead of knocking, they'll stand there and say hello or excuse me or knock knock, but not loud enough to actually be heard, unless you're actually listening for it. This mostly happens with food delivery places, even when I add the instruction, knock on the door loud enough for me to hear it. I'm having trouble thinking of any more to add to this, but there are a lot of annoying things that happen that I just can't be bothered doing anything about, because I realise it's not really that important. Gentleman said, what is your favourite TF2 class character and gameplay wise? I really like the Heavy. He's fun and I like the character. It's especially good when you play with somebody that likes being a doctor, obviously. I'm also quite fond of the pyro. Back in the day when I regularly played TF2, I really enjoyed the whiny babies that get all mad when you burn them, and how they would impotently whine, "Wah, wah, no skill, W plus mouse 1," and things like that. Good times. We played on stream the other week and the game is still quite fun, especially on the server we played on that had a roll the dice function. That was some good sensible fun. Gentleman also asked, "Are you going to get the new Panzer Pants taunt in TF2? I have to admit that I'm kind of surprised that there's new stuff actually being added to the game. I can't remember if the Panzer Pants taunt is free or if you have to pay for it. If you have to pay for it, I won't be getting it. Realistically, I don't see myself playing anywhere near enough to spend money on the game." John asks Jack, I've probably just slaughtered that name, sorry, said, "When will you play another game of Bolt Action solo?" I'm not really sure. I'm thinking that I might be able to set something up over the Christmas period. I do plan to take time off making videos then too, so I may record one or two games over the Christmas period. The thing is, it takes a lot of time to set up, play, and film the game, especially considering that I don't have enough space to set up a table here. It's actually a lot more practical to borrow somebody else's space and set up there. The main thing is that it's a much bigger time investment to record a game than a lot of people seem to understand, and it's been quite hard to find that time lately. Jondell said, "If you were to play Fortnite, how much better do you think you would be than Logan Paul?" I have no idea. Chances are I'm not going to play Fortnite, and I have no idea if I would be better than Logan Paul. To be honest, I wouldn't care if I'm better than him or not. I'm just not a very competitive person, especially when it comes to people who aren't in the slightest bit interesting or relevant to me. The Chieftain said, "What is your favourite strange or out there vehicle from World War II? I mean, the first thing that comes to mind is the TOG 2. It's by no means a good tank, but it has a lot of charm. It didn't see any combat, but it was designed for World War II. Again, not very well, but it does count in my opinion. Either that or the Sherman variant with the giant wheels intended for clearing mines. That's pretty interesting. The Sherman Calliope has to be up there if that counts. Also the Crab Flail tanks. Those were cool. To answer the question, I'm quite indecisive, so I don't know. TOG 2? Ratto said, "How do you get plastic link and length tracks to look so good? Mine always end up not straight and all wombly. I tend to do them slowly and give the glued parts a little time to bond before adding the next link or length. That way it's harder to knock the parts you've already put on out of place. Often I'll clean any mold lines off the next part while waiting for the previous one to bond. It doesn't have to sit for too long, just enough that the part won't just fall right off if you happen to nudge it. It might also be just plain dumb luck." Duncan Hoover said, "Can we build a Herbert Erpaderp, or maybe see a Herbert Erpaderp?" Well, I guess if you want, you can try and build a Herbert Erpaderp, but it would never be more than an imposter. You can certainly see a Herbert Erpaderp though. I'm usually quite visible on my streams, and I guess in the occasional gaming video derived from those streams. There was another question asking if I would do a face reveal, but I did do one ages ago and you can see my face in the streams I do. Quite often I use the video from those streams as background in Ask a Herbert Erpaderp, so I was a bit confused by somebody wanting a face reveal. I guess maybe I've got a little bit off topic there. Ah well, check out my streams I guess is the point in the answer. I stream somewhat regularly, and there's a link to my Twitch channel in the description. I'd appreciate it if you went and checked it out. Australian Train Nut said, "What are your thoughts about Aussie trains being made overseas?" It's not something I know a whole lot about, so here's an uninformed opinion. I do think it's a bit silly. I can understand companies wanting to save money and such, and labour is cheaper in some other countries, so things like trains just get built there. It's just how things work nowadays. I know there have been a number of issues with the new trains Queensland Rail bought from an overseas company, including things like fitting inside the loading gauge. If I had to guess, that's probably a result of cutting corners to keep things nice and cheap. I do think it would be better if the trains were built here in Australia. They probably wouldn't be of any higher quality. I'm not one for nationalism, I'm not going to be all like, "Aussie, Aussie, Aussie," because that's stupid. So I don't think we would necessarily get better trains by virtue of them being made by Australians, but it's clearly better for the local economy to build stuff here. I'm pretty sure the passenger portion of Queensland Rail is still owned by the government, so it's kind of surprising that they would send that work overseas considering how much politicians bang on about creating jobs and supporting Australian industry and things like that. But then we know that politicians are scum, so it's not really surprising at all, is it? Ahmed Jaboa said, "If you were forced to build a 1950 to present day tank, which one would it be?" I'm tempted to say the Centurion. It was in use well after the 50s, but it did come into service in the 40s, so maybe that doesn't count? How about a Patton? That might be interesting. Ducking Tanker said, "Can you say 10.5cm Lichter Feldhauitzer 18-3, Selbstfahrluftwaffe aus Geschützwagen B2, Franzosischen?" Well, I gave it a good try, didn't I? Smoze said, "What decal solution do you use, as Humbrol Decal Fix isn't working very well for me at the moment?" Well, I use Humbrol Decal Fix myself, and it's been working pretty well for me. I don't really have a lot of experience with other decal solutions either, so unfortunately I can't offer much help. I might actually go and pick up some other decal solutions and do some testing. That might be interesting to do. I guess that doesn't really help much right now though, does it? Sorry about that. Some dude said, "Have you heard of the game Brutal Legend? Jack Black is in it." I have. I watched Paul from Loading Ready Run play through it a few years ago, and it did have some pretty cool music. I think watching that may have been enough for me though. I was able to enjoy it enough through the stream, and it's not very likely I'll play it myself. PlaidSquid41030 said, "How many KV2 turrets is too many?" I don't know. How many have you got? Penfold07 said, "How many times did you say rivet counter in your Panzer IV painting video?" This made me curious, so I went back to the script and searched that term. Turns out, I only said it once, though maybe I added it a few more times on the fly during recording. I wasn't curious enough to go and listen to the video again, so the answer is 1. Probably. Penfold07 also said, "You have mentioned several times how you don't like the plastic sprues in individual bags. What other ways could our hobby improve its environmental awareness? I mean, we work with resin, plastic, metal, paints, filler and glues. All of that stuff is disposed of and ends up in landfill and potentially contaminating our waterways. Can we do better?" Of course we can do better. We can always do better. But I don't really have a lot of practical solutions, unfortunately, beyond recycling or reusing whatever you can. Like those bags. I'm pretty sure those are recyclable, and the cardboard box that the model comes in is recyclable too, either by putting it in the recycling bin or just making it into something else. The model companies could cut out a lot of that waste by either putting the sprues in one bag or no bags, though admittedly I do like when there's at least one bag to save parts from being lost if they come off the sprue. It's not really a common occurrence though, so maybe it's not worth it. I guess they bag sprues individually for picking and packing reasons, so that kind of makes sense, but it's still a bit wasteful. Other things like leftover sprues and resin and such might also be a bit of an issue. I don't think you're supposed to throw the sprues in your normal curbside recycling bin, but the plastic is recyclable, though you may have to find the appropriate place to take it to yourself. Or, better yet, chop up the sprues and turn them into other stuff like terrain pieces. I'm actually kind of curious what should be done with leftover resin. Reusing it as terrain or whatever can work, I suppose, but I'm pretty sure it can't be recycled. Myself, I try to reuse as much stuff as I can. Bits of sprue can be really useful in all kinds of situations. I use the same plastic shot glasses over and over again for mixing paint as many times as is feasible, and for holding models or anything else I can think to do with them. Things like that. They're not big things, but they are something. I'm interested in hearing any ideas you guys have that can make the hobby less wasteful. The Tourette's Gamer said, "Hey Herbert, I've procured myself a new rat and was struggling to think of a name. Any ideas?" And they've also included a couple of pictures of a very cute little rat. It has been a while, so you might have thought of a name in the time since asking the question. But how about Sir Eustace von Panzerfaust? Or Old Small Nibbles Boy? Or Reginald? Yeah, I suck at names. You could probably do better yourself. Also, it's 4 a.m. and I'm still sweating my balls off, so I'm not really in a very creative headspace. Sorry about that. Do let us know what you end up naming him. Or her. Jondel said, "Have you ever encountered an emu?" I have, though not in the wild. Or at least I don't think I have. They don't tend to hang out where I live, because it's a pretty built-up area. Not quite a city, but it's fairly populated. And I suspect they much prefer bushland and areas with less humans, understandably. On the previous Ask a Herbert Erpaderp, the big boy said, "I just can't get the thought that when you say next fortnight, it sounds like next fortnight out of my head." Well, I'm actually saying fortnight, though maybe I'm just not enunciating properly. Though it isn't spelled the same way as the game. For those unaware, probably Americans, a fortnight is 2 weeks. The Tourette's Gamer said, "Congratulations, Herbert, on 8,170 plus subscribers. Thanks, it's quite a few more than I thought I had. Also, at the time of recording, we're up to 8,335, which seems like pretty decent growth to me, for a channel like this anyway. It's likely to be even higher by the time this goes public. It does feel pretty good that so many people have taken the time to click subscribe. I mean, those aren't super huge numbers or anything like that, but I'm still pretty proud of what I've accomplished. And it is still growing fairly quickly. Why, I remember way back in the olden days when I had 300 subscribers, and I thought that was a lot. Good times. Thank you all for subscribing." RedGreen09 said, "Living in Australia and know all the animals there are Australian, but do you get some more famous ones in the backyard, like kangaroos or wombats? Or just see birds and a lizard or two? Me, just a red-tailed hawk or vulture or crows. We don't usually get a lot of interesting wildlife in the backyard. The fence is probably a bit too high for most of them to get in anyway, but there is a creek behind my place and the remnants of some bushland nearby. And there are wallabies in the area, though I very, very rarely see them. I did actually see one of them dead on the side of the road having been hit by a car the other day, which made me pretty mad. Some bogan dickhead probably hit that on purpose. And I have seen water dragons in the backyard a couple of times, but like I said before in another question, the wildlife tends to stay away from humans, and that's probably pretty smart on their part, really." Tyler Hensley said, "You should build the Flames of War T-27 American Arty model." I have considered getting that. It's kind of an interesting unit, but I'm pretty sure it's only available in metal, and I would much prefer it in plastic. If in fact it was plastic, I would get one. It's one of those interesting and odd units that I quite like. James Powernall said, "Can you do a video painting US Airborne, preferably in the late war M43 uniform?" I will eventually paint the Airborne figures from the Bolt Action Band of Brothers box set. I don't know what kind of uniform they're wearing, and I don't think I'll be that specific with the uniform. I mean, I'm not going to spend hours researching the most accurate colours for the M43 uniform or anything like that. And I'll probably end up painting them in whatever colours look good to me at the time, while still being close to what the US uniform colour might be. That said, it's not really a high priority. I'm planning to paint my horde of Russian infantry before the US, and those are very slowly being built. It's going to be a big job. That's probably not the most satisfying answer, but it is what it is. And that's the end of the question time for this video. Let's go and check out some of the modelling work that has been posted in the Discord by the community. PanzerKampfwagen3 shared this image stating "Germans attack," also that this is not historically accurate, which doesn't matter at all here. This is all of their 15mm scale German tanks so far. I'm sure there's going to be plenty more. Very nice. Jontel shared these images, saying he decided the war boys that drive the Jeep commonly ram enemy cars, so he gave them a massive plow to play with. This is pretty cool. A very nice use of scrap bits. Here are Top Bunk Productions Rolls-Royces so far, fully assembled and ready for painting. The top one is the Royal Armoured Corps car, and the other one is the desert car to be depicted as one of the Rolls-Royces from the Commando comic Surprise Attack. Very nice work. Top Bunk also shared this Panther, which is the oldest model he owns. It has survived for almost a decade and possibly longer. I really like this. It's actually fairly decently painted and it seems to have held up quite well over the years. I have to say I'm actually a little bit jealous. I kind of wish I had some of the models I painted over a decade ago, if only just to compare with what I can do now. Very cool, thank you for sharing. James Valentine built this here Rubicon OT-3485R. This is a very nice looking model, and we don't even have to wait to see it painted. Here it is. For those wondering, the OT designation makes this a flame-throwing tank. Who doesn't like a little bit of fire? I really like the red colour on this. It's obviously not a historical scheme, or at least I don't think it is, but that doesn't matter. It looks awesome and that's the main thing. I'm always really impressed with your work, James. Keep it up. The Tourette's Gamer finally finished their A-34 Comet Platoon for Flames of War, and asked if anyone likes them. I can't imagine anybody not liking them. They look great. I did comment on Discord that I especially liked the ones doing sick jumps over the walls, and that King Tiger sure has got itself into some trouble. RIP. And here's a 15mm scale Churchill gun carrier. This was a present for the Tourette gamer's dad, and I'm sure he will or did totally love it. It looks really good. As much as I didn't enjoy the Churchill gun carrier in World of Tanks, it's actually a pretty interesting looking vehicle in my opinion, and this one is very nicely painted. I also rather like the image of it coming over the fence to crush the Germans. Sneaky Zaku finished building their own shelter for the Fallout game. It's simple, but very effective. It does look a little bit new for the Fallout universe though, but that can be fixed. See? Here it is painted. This looks really good and much more suited to the Fallout aesthetic. You've done a really good job. Ah, it's the Brotherhood! What do they want? Tell them we don't have any. Tell them to go away. Both the power suit and the shack are really nice work. Makes me think I should get to work on my own Fallout stuff that I've got. If anybody is wondering, by the way, Modifius did eventually send me a set of resin models like they said they would. I just haven't had a chance to build them yet. Also, here are some more of Sneaky Zaku's Fallout Robo Boys, and girls too, why not? Sneaky says that they've been a joy to paint, and they're a joy to look at too. I'm feeling way more motivated to work on my own now, so thank you. Saxton Steele recently painted these angry, hairy, scary boys. They didn't mention who makes the models, but I like them and they've been painted very nicely. Eastern Union shared this Dragon 1/35th scale Type 95 Hargo late version. Eastern Union hopes you like it. I know I do. He mentions that he knows the colours aren't accurate, but I don't think that's really important, as long as you're happy with your model. It is really quite nicely done, and you should be proud of your work. Post-apo Gestapo shared this tiny little Panzer II. This model is in 1/72nd scale and has an interior, which, unfortunately, won't be visible. There have been some modifications though, including adding some brass to the spare wheel and making the vision port opened. Looks pretty cool to me. Who doesn't love a cute little Panzer II? Duncan Uwe just finished this Mirage Blade Liger, which I wouldn't have known if he didn't point it out, is in the middle. Also shown are his Shield Liger and his friends Liger Zero Jaeger. They all look very bitey. Ducking Tanker has been working on this Sherman by adding some planks that look to be strips of styrene, and cables made from hand-twisted wires that were formerly part of a phone charger, which is really nice and resourceful. This is a really good example of reusing things and being less wasteful. She's also made some very nice sandbags for the front of the hull using green stuff. There's more planks here and some, I don't know what that rocky looking stuff is. Is it chopped up sprues? Either way, you've added a lot of interesting stuff here. And that's all the models for this episode of Ask a Herbert Erpaderp. In an effort to not have a 7-hour long video, I've omitted a lot of the pictures that were shared. It's kind of a shame because there's a lot of really good stuff there. If you want to check it all out, head over to the Discord and look in the miniatures channel. There's a link in the description below. Also on the Discord we have an Arts and Crafts channel, so let's have a look at some of the stuff that's been shared in there. Post-apo Gestapo was taking part in Inktober, which is a challenge where you draw something different each day based on a prompt, which seems like a really nice idea if you're into drawing. There's quite a few of these and they're all rather good. Post-apo Gestapo said they were bad, but I disagree and I'm sure I'm not the only one. Though I do totally understand feeling like all your work is bad. I'm pretty sure anybody that does anything creative has that feeling. But these pictures are really good. I have to admit that I can't quite tell what all the prompts for them are, having not really followed Inktober, but you've clearly got some drawing skill. And that's always enjoyable to see. Keep up the amazing work. Pax Britannica shared this Remembrance Day centenary table. There's a Mark I tank in the center. I think this looks really good. I especially like the rivets and such on the sides of the table. Very good work. Top Bunk Productions shared this spooky pumpkin. I've never carved a pumpkin myself, but it does look like it could be fun. Halloween isn't much of a thing here and I'm too lazy, but this one does look pretty cool. And that's it for the art. Since the Arts and Crafts channel doesn't seem to be all that busy, I think I will include this segment on every second Ask a Herbert Erpaderp. That seems kind of sensible to me. Anyway, I want to say a big thank you to everyone who shared their art and modelling work. It's always inspiring to me, and I appreciate seeing everything that gets shared, even though I can't reasonably share all of it here. Also, thanks to everyone who asked a question, even if I didn't answer it here. If you've got something you want me to answer in the next Ask a Herbert Erpaderp in 2 weeks' time, feel free to put it in the comment section below or in the appropriate channel on Discord. Also, if you haven't already, why not do all the liking, subbing, and following things here on YouTube, Twitch, and other social media places? And if you really like the things I do, please consider supporting over on Patreon, where you'll now be able to see my videos up to 4 days early, or by purchasing a shirt or mug from my merch store. Links to all of those things are in the description below. And as always, I shall return soon, so until then, be excellent to each other, and thanks for watching. Farewell.